Books on Tape presents The Age of Turbulence, Adventures in a New World by Alan Greenspan. Read by Robertson Dean. Introduction. On the afternoon of September 11, 2001, I was flying back to Washington on Swiss Air Flight 128, returning home from a routine international bankers' meeting in Switzerland. I'd been moving about the cabin when the chief of the security detail that escorted me on trips abroad, Bob Agnew, stopped me in the aisle. Bob is an ex-Secret Service man, friendly but not especially talkative. At that moment, he was looking grim. "Mr. Chairman," he said quietly, "the captain needs to see you up front. Two planes have flown into the World Trade Center." I must have had a quizzical look on my face, because he added, "I'm not joking." In the cockpit, the captain appeared quite nervous. He told us there had been a terrible attack against our country. Several airliners had been hijacked, and two flown into the World Trade Center and one into the Pentagon. Another plane was missing. That was all the information he had, he said in his slightly accented English. We were returning to Zurich, and he was not going to announce the reason to the other passengers. "Do we have to go back?" I asked. "Can we land in Canada?" He said no. His orders were to head to Zurich. I went back to my seat as the captain announced that air traffic control had directed us to Zurich. The phones on the seats immediately became jammed, and I couldn't get through to the ground. The Federal Reserve colleagues who had been with me in Switzerland that weekend were already on other flights. So, with no way to know how events were developing, I had nothing to do but think for the next 3.5 hours. I looked out the window. The work I'd brought along, the piles of memos and economic reports, forgotten in my bag. Were these attacks the beginning of some wider conspiracy? My immediate concern was for my wife. Andrea is NBC's chief foreign affairs correspondent in Washington. She wasn't in New York, which was one big relief, and visiting the Pentagon hadn't been on her agenda that day. I assumed she would be at the NBC bureau in the middle of town, heavily involved in covering the news, so I wasn't deeply worried, I told myself. But what if she'd gone on a last-minute visit to some general in the Pentagon? I worried about my colleagues at the Federal Reserve. Were they safe? And their families? The staff would be scrambling to respond to the crisis. This attack, the first on U.S. soil since Pearl Harbor, would throw the country into turmoil. The question I needed to focus on was whether the economy would be damaged. The possible economic crises were all too evident. The worst, which I thought highly unlikely, would be a collapse of the financial system. The Federal Reserve is in charge of the electronic payment systems that transfer more than $4 trillion a day in money and securities between banks all over the country and much of the rest of the world. We'd always thought that if you wanted to cripple the U.S. economy, you'd take out the payment systems. Banks would be forced to fall back on inefficient physical transfers of money. Businesses would resort to barter and IOUs. The level of economic activity across the country could drop like a rock. During the Cold War, as a precaution against nuclear attack, the Federal Reserve had built a large number of redundancies into the communication and computer facilities on which the money system relies. We have all sorts of safeguards so that, for example, the data of one Federal Reserve bank are backed up at another Federal Reserve bank hundreds of miles away or in some remote location. In the event of a nuclear attack, we'd be back up and running in all non-irradiated areas very quickly. This system was the one Roger Ferguson, the vice chairman of the Fed, would be calling on this day. I was confident that he and our colleagues would be taking the necessary steps to keep the world dollar system flowing. Yet even as I thought about it, I doubted that physically disrupting the financial system was what the hijackers had in mind. Much more likely, this was meant to be a symbolic act of violence against capitalist America, like the bomb in the parking garage of the World Trade Center 8 years earlier. What worried me was the fear such an attack would create, especially if there were additional attacks to come. In an economy as sophisticated as ours, people have to interact and exchange goods and services constantly, and the division of labor is so finely articulated that every household depends on commerce simply to survive. If people withdraw from everyday economic life, if investors dump their stocks, or business people back away from trades, or citizens stay home for fear of going to malls and being exposed to suicide bombers, there's a snowball effect. It's the psychology that leads to panics and recessions. A shock like the one we just sustained could cause a massive withdrawal from and major contraction in economic activity. The misery could multiply. Long before my flight touched down, I'd concluded that the world was about to change in ways that I could not yet define. The complacency we Americans had embraced for the decade following the end of the Cold War had just been shattered. We finally reached Zurich just after 8:30 p.m. local time, still early afternoon in the United States. Swiss banking officials met me as I got off the plane and rushed me to a private room in the departure lounge. They offered to show videos of the Twin Towers coming down and the fires at the Pentagon, but I declined. I'd worked in the neighborhood of the World Trade Center for much of my life and had friends and acquaintances there. I assumed the death tolls would be horrendous and would include people I knew. I didn't want to see the destruction. I just wanted a phone that worked. I finally reached Andrea on her cell phone a few minutes before 9, and it was a great relief to hear her voice. Once we'd assured each other we were okay, she told me she had to rush. She was on the set, about to go on the air with an update of the day's events. I said, "Just tell me quickly what's happening there." She was holding the cell phone to one ear while the special events producer in New York was on her earpiece in the other ear, almost shouting, "Andrea, Tom Brokaw is coming to you. Are you ready?" All she had time to say was, "Listen up." With that, she put the open cell phone on her lap and addressed the cameras. I heard exactly what America was hearing at that point, that the missing United Flight 93 had crashed in Pennsylvania. I was then able to get a call through to Roger Ferguson at the Fed. We ran through our crisis management checklist, and just as I'd figured, he had things well in hand. Then, with all civilian air travel to the United States shut down, I contacted Andy Card, the White House Chief of Staff, to request transportation back to Washington. Finally, I went back to the hotel, escorted by my security detail, to get some sleep and await instructions. By daybreak, I was airborne again, on the flight deck of a United States Air Force KC-10 tanker. It may have been the only aircraft available. The crew was used to flying refueling sorties over the North Atlantic. The mood in the cockpit was somber. "You'll never believe this," the captain said. "Listen." I put my ear to the headset, but couldn't hear anything other than static. "Normally, the North Atlantic is full of radio chatter," he explained. "This silence is eerie." Apparently, nobody else was out there. As we came down the eastern seaboard and entered prohibited U.S. airspace, we were met and escorted by a couple of F-16 fighters. The captain got permission to fly over what had been the site of the Twin Towers at the southern tip of Manhattan, now a smoking ruin. For decades, my offices had never been more than a few blocks from there. During the late 1960s and early 1970s, I had watched day by day as the Twin Towers went up. Now, from 35,000 feet, their smoky wreckage was New York's most visible landmark. I went straight to the Fed that afternoon, driven with a police escort through barricaded streets. Then we went to work. For the most part, the electronic flows of funds were doing fine. But with civilian air traffic shut down, the transportation and clearing of good old-fashioned checks were being delayed. That was a technical problem, a substantial one, but one that the staff and the individual Federal Reserve banks were entirely capable of handling by temporarily extending additional credit to commercial banks. I spent most of my time in the days that followed watching and listening for signs of a catastrophic economic slowdown. For 7 months before 9/11, the economy had been in a very minor recession, still shaking off the effects of the dot-com crash of 2000. But things had started to turn around. We had rapidly been lowering interest rates, and the markets were beginning to stabilize. By late August, public interest had shifted from the economy to Gary Condit, the California congressman whose less-than-forthcoming statements about a missing young woman dominated the nightly news. Andrea couldn't get on the air with anything of global significance, and I remember thinking how incredible that seemed. The world must be in pretty good shape if the TV news focused mainly on domestic scandal. Within the Fed, the biggest issue we faced was how far to lower interest rates. After 9/11, the reports and statistics streaming in from the Federal Reserve banks told a very different story. The Federal Reserve System consists of 12 banks strategically situated around the country. Each one lends money to and regulates the banks in its region. The Federal Reserve banks also serve as a window on the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.